Good afternoon. Welcome to the Transportation Committee. Let me start out with a few announcements. Assemblymember Holly Mitchell will be replacing Assemblymember Furutani today. We have a vote on adopting committee policy on highway naming resolutions. Our agenda, let me give you a few bills that have been put over. AB 937 by Mendoza has been laid over. AB 1229 by Assemblymember Fuhrer has been laid over. On the consent calendar, we have four items, item 13, 14, 15, and 16. AB 427 by Perez, AB 615 by myself, AB 957 by the Transportation Committee, and AB 1092 by myself. We have two items that are on consent with amendments. Item 17, AB 348 by Assemblymember Buchanan. And item 18, AB 892 by Assemblymember Carter. Because we have a very lengthy agenda and we want to give everyone an opportunity to speak, we will allow two witnesses each for support and opposition. And witnesses will be limited to 2 minutes each. Following that, others will be allowed to state their name and affiliation and position. Do we have a quorum yet?
I think we do. Yes.
We have a quorum. Madam Secretary, could you call the roll, please?
Lowenthal?
Here.
Jeffries?
Here.
Shajian?
Here.
Blumenfield? Tania?
Here.
Buchanan? Ing?
Here.
Mitchell? Galgiani?
Here.
Loaf?
And then after that, we start.
Miller?
To consent, and then we start.
Norby?
Here.
Portantino?
Here.
Solorio?
Here.
We have a quorum.
We have a quorum, so we can begin by talking about the resolution on naming highways or structures. The number of memorial highway naming resolutions introduced by the legislature has increased steadily over the last two decades. Most recently, in the 2009-10 legislative session, 56 memorial naming resolutions were introduced and passed. All of them heard in policy and fiscal committees, passed on the floor of both houses, and ultimately adopted, and none of them received a single opposing vote. Given the increasing numbers of memorial naming resolutions, it is expected that Caltrans costs associated with the namings will also increase despite reductions in budget and staffing. Money collected to pay for the memorial signs, which are paid by non-state sources, are not protected special fund dollars and are not directly accessible to the department because they are typically redirected to general fund relief purposes, creating a situation whereby Caltrans is producing, erecting, and maintaining memorial signs without receiving any additional staff resources. It should be the policy of this committee to discourage highway memorial legislation for the remainder of this legislative session. This will free Caltrans highway staff to work on higher priority activities. Admittedly, halting the practice of naming highway memorials is a small move toward budget solvency, but this program adds little value compared to enormous needs elsewhere in the highway program overall. Yes, Mr. Norby.
I'll move it if you need a motion, Madam Chair. I strongly support this. I believe that the purpose of a highway or road is to transport motorists. That is its purpose, and that's the purpose that it should concentrate on. Every sign by a highway should be geared toward motorist safety. It should be informational signs that gear them toward getting where they want to go, alerting them to dangers, and other types of information. Highway distractions are bad enough with cell phones and iPods and kids in the car and radios, that motorist attention is very, very critical.
And I am concerned about the ratcheting effect of memorial signage along highways. When they're passed, my understanding, Madam Chair, is there's no time limit involved, so it's in fact a ratcheting effect, and if it continues to go at the current pace, there'll literally be tens of thousands of these all throughout the state, which will have no statute of limitations, no funding to pay for them, and will continue to involve our roads in signage which does not help the motorist for the primary purpose of that. My understanding is about a third of all bills heard before this committee last year, my recollection, were renaming bills. 30% is a lot of bills to go through a committee that has very, very serious work to do. Certainly, we want to honor the dead and those who paid the ultimate sacrifice, whether to our state, our city, our country, but I believe there are more appropriate ways of doing it, Madam Chair, and I strongly support this measure.
Mr. Ashatian.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I don't feel as strongly about this as does Mr. Norby, for the reasons that those of us who make it safer for us on the freeway are the California Highway Patrol. I see it very fitting that if an officer was to lose his or her life for the sake of our safety, that they will be honored. I would oppose, or I would support a moratorium for any other people that are as important in what they do, but I feel like moratorium should not apply for the CHP officers. And if the information piece becomes a piece of information that the driver should not involve himself or herself reading, the colors can be of a different color than the information signs do, and that will also take care of the driver's attention while driving. And when we speak of cell phones and iPods and all that, there are already laws that forbids the driver from using them. Thank you.
Mr. Jeffries.
I guess I have a question on the intent to how this will be applied. If bills are already introduced, I believe one of our Assembly colleagues has a bill for naming a highway. Is that bill then dead now because it hasn't been heard by today? That Martin Garrick has a bill waiting to come to us. I don't support the way it's currently drafted, but I understand and would actually agree. I guess my concern is similar to what was just stated. I have a volunteer firefighter who had responded to, this was years ago, but we're just trying to get it to this committee, who responded to a traffic accident on a state highway, trying to save lives on that state highway, and then was hit by a vehicle and killed on a state highway. And now we won't be able to name that section on behalf of that fallen firefighter. I agree that it is seeing a little too much use. But I also think that when you have a Caltrans worker who was killed working on a state highway, or a CHP officer, law enforcement, firefighter, there should be some sort of carve-out ability to recognize those individuals who are giving their lives on state property to save the public's life. And so I think there should be some sort of carve-out identified so that we can address those. The rest can wait for a process to be cleaned up, but I guess I'd have to ask the chair to consider some sort of refinement, if she would, at a later date.
Thank you. Mr. Solorio.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I appreciate you bringing this resolution forward. I think I like its direction, which is to discourage these types of resolutions, but I think where we maybe need to do additional work is how we implement it. I mean, I still see this as saying that on a case-by-case basis we could consider these types of resolutions, but, you know, you asking all members of the legislature for a little bit of restraint in what they put forward, I think, would be appropriate. I think, as has been mentioned, you know, sometimes there are members of law enforcement or Caltrans workers that may pass. And sometimes these recommendations are local recommendations by local Caltrans districts or local cities. And so what I don't want to see is that we have just a policy that is always to recommend no. Also, I think that this analysis here points to the cost by Caltrans in helping erect some of these memorials. Maybe we might want to look to see what are the associated costs with that, and maybe in terms of the fundraising aspect, we ask sponsors to raise more dollars for that. I just know that as a member of this committee, I've been here for a while, these resolutions typically are on the consent, so we don't really have a sense of how many they are, the cost to Caltrans, but maybe it's time to kind of analyze those past resolutions. And again, if they're increased cost to Caltrans, maybe as part of the fundraising, we help make that up so that there's no cost to the state. So appreciate the policy, but maybe you know, today or at a later date, we could figure out how we're going to implement it. Thank you.
Mr. Ng.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And I want to, first of all, commend the chair for having a long-range view of the highway namings. And I know we've had previous chairs who just kind of rubber-stamped them before you and just kind of let the problem build. And, you know, shame on them. But seriously, I just have a question. Is the moratorium, if I can use the word, for just this session? Could I have a clarification? Yes. Is the moratorium just for this
that
session?
That is correct, for the remainder of this legislative session. It is a moratorium.
Yes.
It is not a
and
complete
I,
ban.
It was just brought to my attention just this morning, and unfortunately rather late, that highway patrol officers would be included in this moratorium. And I know that there are concerns. I carried a bill for an individual who I think it took 30 years for him to get a highway named after him, and that shouldn't be. I will support the bill on one condition, that we work really hard to, number one, get rid of the backlog. Number two, have some realistic figures. I helped to fund a sign that just got erected last week, and I paid for it, most of it out of my own pocket, but at least about three-fourths of it out of my own pocket. And I was given the figure that Caltrans gave me. And then the figure for the vendors is a figure from the vendors to put the sign, to erect the sign. So if that's not a realistic figure, then I don't know why Caltrans is giving us a figure in which they operate at a loss, because we pay for it. Or the families pay for it, someone pays for it. So that would have been my second thing, to try to have some kind of a realistic cost assessment. And then three, let's have a policy that provides and informs the legislature in terms of perhaps there should be a priority. And I think, you know, for highway patrol officers, you know, we're the state legislature, you know, a highway patrol officer works for us and in service to the citizens of California, and ought not they have, you know, the respect in death that they had in life. So these are things that I would like to see us work on during the interim, if that's possible, and I urge all the stakeholders to do that. But I think I will be supporting this with those conditions. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Ng. Mr. Portantino.
Yeah, I have a question. Is the Senate doing a similar policy? Are they discussing the same issue?
I'm not aware of it, but it's likely that they will.
Because
I mean, after all, we are in the same bind. The Senate, the Assembly, the lack of funding, and again, the monies that are collected will go back to the general fund. So Caltrans is not able to fund this. What we're doing, Mr. Portantino, as I see it, is taking a good hard look at something that's gone on for years and years, for very good reason. For very good reason. Each of us knows individually someone worthy of that dedication, and I don't question that at all, public safety or otherwise. But the state doesn't have the money to continue as it has been. So for that reason, and along with, I think, Mr. Ng's suggestions, if we create this moratorium until the end of the session, we'll be able to take a better look at it, we'll be able to save the money, and hopefully come back in a couple of years and continue in a different format where it would fully pay for itself and where we wouldn't be spending the amount of time that we do. I'm sorry, I think I cut you off by my fervor.
Yeah, it seems like we should know if they are going to have a similar policy or not, sort of definitively, because if we have a policy and they don't and they send their bills over here, you know, it just seems that the two houses, maybe we should bring this back when the two houses have a chance to get on the same page, so to speak. Seems like there's been some other questions about refining it that have been just a suggestion that maybe the two houses should work together and come together with a policy versus having their bills come over if we adopt it and they don't.
If they had bills on namings, we would not hear them after we create this policy.
And that sort of goes to my point that maybe the two houses should discuss a policy together.
Ms. Galtiani.
I just wanted clarification. This session, does that mean this year or does it mean this two-year session?
This two-year two session.
Years. Okay, thank you.
Mr. Ashajian.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, you bring up a very good point when it comes to the funding of this science, and I think we can bring a policy that says no more funding available, because what I've seen with the private sector, when a local person names goes up, we do local fundraiser to pay. I'm sure any organization with CHP, for example, can do those funding on a local level to help bring the name of a fallen officer onto the freeways. That's a comment. My question is, if we're going to put a moratorium for this session and next session, does that mean following the following session we get bombarded with number of applications then, and how do we deal with that?
We don't know what's going to happen 2 years from now or less than 2 years. We certainly hope the economy is going to be in a different place, and we also would hope that Caltrans would have more staff at that time.
What I'm wondering, if it's still, we go back to the funding mechanism, that we have the policy move forward by not making any funds available, then the organization themselves have to come up with the funding to pay for the expenses.
But that wouldn't cover the Caltrans staff.
Well,
that's what I'm trying to get.
Figuring into the Caltrans staff's cost into the funds that expected the organization to bring forward.
That's something we could look at when
Thank
it
you.
Comes back. Thank you, Mr. Solorio.
Yeah, just to follow up also on that point, you know, when I first read this, I thought we're just talking about discouraging this type of legislation, but a few people have mentioned moratorium. If that's the case, I don't know that I could support it. I know, too, if the focus is on costs, we don't have any information here about whether Caltrans loses money or makes money on this. I mean, we have one member here who, you know, paid the bill that Caltrans sent. I don't know how much these signs cost, whether we make money, lose money. If we are a little bit short, maybe we should just up it. We also don't have Caltrans saying whether there's this is adding too much to their workload that they can't handle. Again, the policy of just discouraging, it's one thing, but I think we should consider, you know, the real cost to this and maybe cheering them based off of, you know, if there are individuals that do pass who are state employees, I think we should consider it. So for us to have a outright moratorium, I think, is a little bit too much. But maybe just following up on how we can discourage it and verifying the cost associated, I think, would be prudent before voting to halt this permanently without additional information. Thanks.
Was there anyone else?
Mr. Bonnie.
Mr. Norby, last comment.
The issue is more than just money, Madam Chair. I want to commend you for bringing this up. But it's really about the signage process itself. People are driving down the freeway. Some freeways have two names. They'll have a number plus a name. And when you add signage which says this is the name of this freeway or the name of this highway, And you've got about 60 a year, multiply that by next 50 years, I mean, these will be in the thousands. There really is an issue of the integrity of the name of the highway itself. And there are other ways of memorializing people without a quarter-mile stretch of highway being named after them, the name of which is never going to be used by motorists, will probably never appear on a map, and really is information that the motorists can't use. I had a CHP officer killed in my city when I was Mayor Fullerton back in 96, and we put a plaque behind a gas station where he was at, where he was shot. We had a service for him. We did all that, but we didn't feel we had to rename a quarter of a mile stretch of freeway nearby. There are other ways of memorializing people without getting into the business of renaming and creating names which don't really help the motorist, and which, if we don't look at the ratcheting effect of this, will continue on infinitum and create issues which we need to discuss. And I want to commend you for bringing this up, and I support it as is.
I think we've reached the end of a discussion. Members, the information has been out for many weeks now. We did not receive any feedback by the end of last week from other members. And so I think we're going to take the vote now. I understand there are some differences of opinion. But Madam Secretary, could you call the roll?
Lowenthal?
Aye.
Lowenthal, aye. Jeffries?
I'm going to stay off.
Achajian?
No.
Chajian, no. Blumenfeld?
Aye.
Blumenfeld, aye. Bonilla?
Aye.
Bonilla, aye. Buchanan? Ng? Ng, aye.
Aye.
Mitchell? Galgiani? Logue? Miller? Norby?
Aye.
Norby, aye. Portantino? Solorio.
Five, one. We're going to hold the roll open for that. And we're going to move on to the consent calendar. Could you call the roll, please?
Motion to approve.
Second.
I did.
Lowenthal? Aye. Lowenthal, aye. Jeffries?
Aye.
Jeffries, aye. Achajian?
Aye.
Achajian, aye. Blumenfeld?
Aye.
Blumenfeld, aye. Bonilla?
Aye.
Bonilla, aye. Buchanan?
Aye.
Buchanan, aye. Ng?
Aye.
Ng, aye. Mitchell? Galgiani? Logue? Miller? Norby?
Aye.
Norby, aye. Portantino? Solorio?
Aye.
Solorio, aye.
9-0 The consent calendar is out. We're going to start out with AB 16, Assemblymember Perea.
Madam Chair, members, thank you. Good afternoon. Thank you for the opportunity to present my bill. I will be very brief. AB 16 would require the High Speed Rail Authority to make every effort to purchase high-speed rail, high-speed train rolling stock, and related equipment that are manufactured in California. California is experiencing a dismal unemployment rate of 12.4%, with some regions of the state faring far worse. Currently, there are eight counties with unemployment rates above 20%. In my district, there are many areas that are experiencing an unemployment rate of 40%, and in some cases, even higher. According to the U.S. Department of Commerce, the number of construction jobs created by a heavy engineering project, such as high-speed rail, can create up to 32,000 direct and indirect jobs for every $1 billion spent in California. The High-Speed Rail Authority is assuming the number of jobs created by this project would exceed over 800,000 jobs. Now, I'll just close in saying this. I know there might be some differences of opinion on high-speed rail, and some may support it and some may not. This bill is not about that. What this bill is about, whether or not we believe when high-speed rail moves forward, if Californians should benefit by all the jobs that are going to be created from this project. I happen to believe that since Californians are putting up taxpayer dollars for this, then we should be using it to put Californians back to work. And so I would respectfully ask for your aye vote. Here to testify in support of this bill, we have Sarah Phlox, representing the California Labor Federation, and Shane Guzman from the Machinist Union. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Members, Sarah Phlox from the California Labor Federation. We're proud to sponsor this bill this year. We think this is a smart way to attract high-speed rail manufacturers to locate in California to create jobs and to build a new industry of transportation manufacturing in the state. Currently, all high-speed rail is manufactured abroad, outside of this country. But today, California has the opportunity to use public funds to attract those manufacturers to this state and to create jobs. We know that there's already considerable private sector interest in this project. There was a recent request for expressions of interest by the High Speed Rail Authority. Over 1,100 responses came in from private sector businesses, including many high-speed rail manufacturers. So we know they're already gearing up. They already have their sights set on this project and to manufacture the trains that California is going to purchase to put to use. So this bill is basically sending a message saying, we want you to locate in California. We'll create that incentive. We want these trains to be manufactured here. And it's especially important to send that message now as the manufacturers are gearing up and to let them know they need to locate here. Currently, we don't have any manufacturing, and it's going to take some work to be able to get them here, to create those long-term jobs, and to create good manufacturing jobs, which also will have a multiplier effect of 2.5 jobs in the broader economy for every job they create here. So we respectfully ask for your aye vote. Thank you.
Madam Chair, members of the committee, Shane Guzman on behalf of the California Conference of Machinists and also the Teamsters in support of the bill. Over the last decade, we've lost hundreds of thousands of manufacturing jobs in California, and we are supporting policies that the state can get directly engaged in creating jobs in California, good manufacturing jobs. So we urge your aye vote on the bill.
Any other witnesses in support? State your name and affiliation. Witnesses in opposition. Any other comments? Would you like to close, Mr. Padilla?
Just respectfully ask for your aye vote. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm very supportive of your bill. I appreciate you bringing it forward. Jobs are our number one priority, and I'm in total agreement. My vote will be in support. Madam Secretary.
Do you pass to appropriations? Lowenthal?
Aye.
Lowenthal, aye. Jeffries?
Aye.
Jeffries, aye. Ashajian?
Aye.
Ashajian, aye. Blumenfield?
Aye.
Blumenfield, aye. Bonilla?
Aye.
Bonilla, aye. Buchanan?
Aye.
Buchanan, aye. Ng?
Aye.
Ng, aye. Mitchell? Galgiani? Logue? Miller? Norby?
No.
Norby, no. Portantino. Solorio.
Aye.
Solorio, aye. 8-1, the bill's out.
8-1, your bill is out, Mr. Perea. Mr. Berryhill. AB 286. Put your mic on, Mr. Berryhill.
Yes. I'm presenting AB 286. Madam Chair, members of the committee, recently Caltrans purchased large amounts of property in the northern Stanislaus County to construct the 120 bypass around the city of Oakdale, but never built the facilities. As such, Caltrans expects to declare the property surplus and is now working with the Stanislaus Council of Governments, Stanislaus County, as well as the City of Oakdale to plan for the sale of these properties. An interregional alternative called the North County Corridor to the dropped Oakdale Bypass Project is currently being pursued together by Caltrans and a joint powers authority whose members consist of the cities of Modesto, Oakdale, Riverbank, Stanislaus County, Stanislaus Council of Governments, as well as Caltrans. If enacted, AB 286 would provide the proceeds from the eventual sale of these unneeded parcels and will be used to fund the North County Corridor Project, as was the intent of the money spent by Caltrans originally. I'd also like to thank today the committee staff for working with my office and the sponsor on the amendment that brings AB 286 into compliance with AB 105 from March of last year. AB 105 encumbers any proceeds from the sale of Caltrans surplus properties to repay debt until July 1st of 2013. The committee amendment we are accepting simply states that if the property is sold prior to July 1st, 2013, the proceeds would be governed by the provisions of AB 105. AB 286 is modeled generally after a bill that this committee approved and was signed into law in 2009. I'd like to thank your staff, as well as Caltrans, for developing this measure and making this a better bill. With me today are Matt Machado and Gus Corey, representing Stanislaus County, to testify and answer any technical questions that you might have. Gus?
Thank you, Madam Chair, members. Gus Corey here on behalf of the County of Stanislaus. I think Mr. Berryhill said it all. This bill would basically redirect proceeds from a sale of property for a more prudent use to improve goods movement and traffic congestion, not just within the county, but within the region, and we respectfully ask for your aye vote.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair and members.
Put your mic on, please.
The light's on. Oh, thank you. Good afternoon, Madam Chair, members. My name is Matt Machado. I'm the Director of Public Works for Stanislaus County and also the Authority Manager for the North County Corridor. Just to add a bit, the North County Corridor does have great support from the California Transportation Commission. Last year, we received a favorable vote to replace the Oakdale Bypass Project with the North County Corridor Project. So this is a valuable investment in transportation in our region, and we greatly appreciate your support today. And with that, we're happy to answer any questions that you may have. Thank you.
Any other witnesses in support? Witnesses in opposition? Comments from members? Would you like to close, Mr. Berryhill?
I appreciate the opportunity, and I just request an aye vote. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I believe that you have addressed an important concern in Stanislaus County. Appreciate your taking the amendments, and I'm going to support this bill. Could you call the roll?
Motions to pass as amended to appropriations. Lowenthal?
Aye.
Lowenthal, aye. Jeffries?
Aye.
Jeffries, aye. Ashajian? Blumenfeld?
Aye.
Blumenfeld, aye. Bonilla?
Aye.
Bonilla, aye. Buchanan? Ng?
Aye.
Ng, aye. Mitchell?
Aye.
Mitchell, aye. Galgiani? Logue? Logue, aye. Miller? Norby?
Aye.
Norby, aye. Portantino? Solorio?
Aye.
Solorio, aye.
9-0. 9-0. Your bill is out. Thank you. The next author who's here would be Mr. Norby.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
We pass many laws here. We consider many bills. Some become laws, some don't. Thousands of laws are passed. Some are strictly enforced, some gather dust. There are higher laws which we have to obey whether we want to or not, like the law of gravity, law of supply and demand in economics. And one is the law of unintended consequences. When a law is passed, it has the intention to do one thing, but in fact, something else happens. And that's why in the end, we must continually reevaluate our laws, not based on their original intention, but based on their actual result. And AB 695 is intended to do just that. The mandatory motorcycle helmet law, which was passed in California, was intended to save lives. In fact, it has not done that. The mandatory helmet law was intended to make California safer than the 27 states in the Union who do not have mandatory adult helmet laws. But it hasn't done that. In fact, if you look at the statistics, the number of fatal accidents and the lethality of those accidents since the original adult helmet bill was passed in 1991 has gone up. 3.22, 3% of all motorcycle accidents in 1991, before the helmet law was passed, were fatal. Now it's 3.53. Just a few years ago, it was up to 4.27. So it has not improved the safety of motorcycle riders in the state. At best, it's a wash, and at worst, it's gotten a little bit worse. Now, you may think, well, why? A helmet will make my head safer. But there are a lot of other things involved. It's been proven that people who ride motorcycles with helmets, just like people who ride bicycles with helmets, tend to take greater risks than those that don't because they feel safer. Motorists seeing a bicycle rider without a helmet tend to drive more safely than those with a helmet. I ought to know. I ride around Sacramento all the time without a helmet, and everybody's always yelling at me and recognizing me and giving me a wide berth because they see the 61-year-old guy with an exposed head, and they see my face, and they drive pretty safely around me. Now, you could argue if I had a helmet, I'd be safer, but there are, like I say, unintended consequences, and this is intended to apply not to bicycles anyway, but to motorcycles. There's also the comparison with other states. California is only one of 20 states that requires motorcycle helmets for all people. 27 require them only for those under 18, and 3 have no such helmet laws at all. Now, you don't need to take my word for it. Here's a study, a very scholarly study done by the University of Nebraska at Lincoln, the only comprehensive study done on the effectiveness of mandatory adult motorcycle helmet laws. And the study shows conclusively that there is no proof statistically that these laws make riding a motorcycle any safer. There's another principle in our legal system as well, and that is that children should be treated as children and adults should be treated as adults. We've chosen the age 18. It varies country by country, but generally in the United States, it's 18. After 18, there are a lot of things you can do legally that you can't do before 18. And all AB 695 does is restore that dividing line. It keeps the mandatory helmet law for minors, but changes it for those who are adults. They may make the choice, as adults should in a free society, whether or not to wear that helmet. Doubtless, many of them will continue to do so, but others may not. I have a number of speakers here, Madam Chair, and a number of people in the audience that are not saying it's good to wear a helmet or bad not to wear a helmet or the other way around. They're simply saying, treat us like adults. We can make the decisions about our own lives, and there's no evidence that this law, in fact, has saved lives. Leave it to us.
Madam Chair, members of the committee, James Lombardo on behalf of Abeta California. I happen to have been here the year that AB 7 passed. I testified and on that bill. And let me just tell you that we were in the same situation we are right now. Well, not the same. They only had a $15 billion budget. I think that'd probably be a better place to be than where we are now. And part of that proposal was a motorcycle helmet law would save money and save lives. We also had a penalty provision by the federal government that was withholding money from the state of California if we didn't have a mandatory safety law. The motorcycle riders went to Washington, D.C., and in 1995 we were successful in passing that so our state would not lose highway building money or highway safety money. Another point in the analysis here where it talks about, as you can see, that motorcycle fatalities went down the first year, but so did the number of registrations. So if we took half the cars off the road or half the big trucks off the road, we would certainly expect that we'd have half the accidents and half the fatalities. It doesn't make much sense. But what that did was cause a revenue loss. And over the last, between, in the analysis, it talks about $191 million lost in Department of Motor Vehicle registration fees. Finally, I'd like to say that a helmet doesn't stop you from having an accident. It's just if something happens, which usually it's a car turning in front of a motorcycle. It's the motorcycle hitting the side of the car at a high speed from the automobile as well as the motorcycle with a failure to yield. And most of the injuries, we had a thoracic surgeon testify 2 years after the bill passed, that are thoracic injuries. It's to the heart, the lungs, and other parts of the body. But finally, I'll close with the following year, Assemblyman Caldevera introduced 2268, which required all bicyclists to wear bicycle helmets. That bill passed his committee, went to Appropriations Committee, passed there. But when it got to the Assembly floor, members of the legislature said, wait a minute, we're adults. We don't need to wear helmets. And they amended that to say only 18-year-olds and under. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Next witness, please.
Let me fix this. My name is Jeff Ray. I'm here on behalf of the Modified Motorcycle Association and 7 confederations of clubs throughout California. They ask that you vote yes on this bill and return their rights to make a choice.
Thank you very much. Are there any other witnesses in support? Give your name and affiliation.
Madam Chair, Committee, Johnny O'Kane, represent motorcyclists through Abate, State of California, and I represent workers through the Los Angeles Orange County Building Trades, and we're in support of this wholeheartedly.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in support? Please give your name and affiliation.
Mark Temple. I represent motorcyclists who have decided, they've found that it's very expensive to prosecute helmet tickets in California courts.
Thank you. Name and affiliation, please.
My name is Dave Quill. I am the CEO for the MMA and also with the COC. I'm supporting this bill, and I ask everyone to please give us our rights back and vote yes. Thank you.
Thank you. Name and affiliation.
Gus Alvarez, also with the MMA of California, Vice President, and also with the COC of clubs. I ask for you guys to please vote yes.
Next witness, please.
My name is Debbie Quill. I'm a concerned citizen and a member of the MMA, and I ask for an aye vote.
Thank you.
My name is Brian Fredette. I am also a member of the MMA, and I urge your vote. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Yvette Mulholland, and I am an editor of a motorcycle magazine, and I encourage your yes vote.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Dana Davidson. I'm the founder of the Sisters of SCOTA Women's Motorcycle Club. I'm also a lifetime member of HOG, Abate, MMA. I also, my club belongs to all of the COCs here in the state of California. I've been riding for 34 years. I remember the day when we had freedom to be helmetless. Please vote aye on this bill and give us back our freedoms.
Thank you. Next witness. Member, name and affiliation, please.
I'm Dave Fallman. I'm a motorcycle instructor for the CMSP. I urge your vote for giving us back our right to decide.
Thank you.
Greetings, Bob Blatz from Local 15 of Contra Costa County, and I'm in favor of this bill. Thank you.
Bobby Smurl, Office Manager, Secretary for the Modified Motorcycle Association of California, and I support this bill and ask you to please vote yes. Let those who ride decide. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Ruby Weber. Abate and MMA, and I belong to most of the MROs. Please vote yes on this bill for us.
Thank you.
Chris Barnes, lifetime member of MMA, president of Wind and Fire at Hangtown. I respectfully ask for your yes vote on this. Thank you.
Dale Gretzinger, standard California citizen and motorcycle rider. Been riding 34 years. Enjoyed the freedom when I lived in Wisconsin, where there is no mandatory helmet law. And I'd like to have the freedom to ride the same here in California. Thank you. Please, I'm sorry for your vote yes, please.
Thank you. Next witness.
My name's Michael Clayton. I've been involved with the MMA since its conception. I've ridden over 750,000 miles on a motorcycle. I would like to be able to hear better. Please let me remove my helmet. I would like you to consider a yes vote. Thank you.
Thank you.
Rob Cheney with EMS Angels and a paramedic licensed in the state of California. Also a motorcyclist. I actually respond to a lot of accidents that involve motorcyclists. Helmets do not protect as much as people, a lot of people think. We would like a yes vote. Thank you.
Thank you.
Jim Scanlon, belong to the MMA COC and the UBNC of Butte County. Would like your support for this bill. Thank you.
Steve Caden, Abate Local 33 President. We'd like to have our freedom back and your support from this bill. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in support? Witnesses in opposition? Gentlemen, could you perhaps make room for... Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair and members. Teresa Stark with the California Medical Association representing California physicians. We are in opposition to this bill. We consistently oppose this measure. We are very concerned about the public health impact of this legislation. Certainly, motorcycle fatalities are a concern that we all should share, and the fact that they are increasing is something that I think everybody on this committee and everybody in this room should take a concerted effort to look at. It's something that our traffic safety experts and our Office of Traffic Safety and the CHP and the individuals here should definitely work on. It is a concern. But we definitely think that going backwards in terms of motorcycle safety is not the right approach. The California Office of Traffic Safety has said that just last year, in 2009, there were a number of lives that were saved because of the helmet law. Traumatic brain injury and other head injuries are devastating injuries that can have a very negative impact on families, on an individual's quality of life, as well as on society. Physicians of California urge your no vote on this bill today. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Manolo Platin, representing the Personal Insurance Federation. I'd like to associate myself with the comments of Ms. Stark. PIF, who represents the large auto insurance companies, you know, we oppose this measure for a very simple reason, in that repealing the helmet will result in increase of severity of motorcycle injuries and death. And this is stuff that we pay for and look after our customers for. One final point that I'd make, not to take too much of this committee's time, but you know, in this day and era of health insurance problems and people not being able to gain access, we really look at this as something that becomes society's problem, as the CMA said. And with, as we're all very aware, the availability of health insurance is, you know, it's tough these days, and your auto insurance might not cover you to the limits that, you know, a traumatic brain injury would, you know, the costs in the hospital. So, you know, to the extent that the injuries are covered by insurance, the increased claims raise the cost for everyone. And to the extent that they're not, it raises the cost for the public. So for those reasons, we oppose this bill. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair and members. Paula Labrie with AAA of Northern California. We also oppose to the bill. Thank you.
Madam Chair, members of the committee, Tim Chang with the Auto Club of Southern California, opposing the bill.
Any other witnesses in opposition? What I would like to do is ask the CHP to come up and let us know what they think of this bill. I'd like to know what concerns law enforcement has about the bill.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair, members. Captain Brown with the California Highway Patrol. We do not have an official position on the bill at this time, but we'd like to answer your questions for you.
What concerns does law enforcement have about this bill?
As currently written by the author, from an enforcement perspective, it would be difficult for an officer to be able to discern which rider operator completed the CMSP program or class in order for them to have or possess the M1 license. That's one. Number two, current riders and operators that did not take that course or that program, how would we go back and make sure that they had that program in place? Statistically, we also have seen that since the bill's inception, or if we go back as close to 2005, there have been over 180,000 additional motorcycles registered in the state of California. And we have seen a decrease in death. So looking at the statistics that are out there, both from the medical perspective and collision investigations, we see that most, about 75% of the fatalities or deaths from traffic collisions involving motorcyclists are due to head injuries. The other 25% are distributed along multi-systems trauma, thoracic, abdominal, pelvic, and extremities.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions? Ms. Mitchell.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Mr. Norby, I've, over the years, dating back to the Dick Floyd, I think, legislation, the primary argument I've always heard is kind of a personal right. I was struck by one of your witnesses in support who talked about his ability to hear better. Can you comment on that? That's just the first time I've heard an argument outside of the notion of personal freedom. So I'm just curious about that.
The helmet does severely restrict the rider's ability to hear, whether it's the horn of a semi-truck or the siren of a police officer. There are also vision issues involved. And so anytime you get something like this, there are trade-offs. And there are negatives as well as positive trade-offs. You've heard the CHP say they have no position on the bill. Now, when he was dragged out a little bit further, we got some additional comments there. But law enforcement has no position on this. And I think, as one person articulately said, let those who ride decide. I've never ridden a motorcycle in my life on a public highway. They have. And all I'm asking, all they're asking, is give them the same adult privileges that people in 31 other states have. There's no evidence that this has saved lives. In fact, the fatality rate per accident has gone up as a result of this. So we should base this on facts, not fear, and based it on real information, not just a few anecdotes. I'll let that be my close, Madam Chair, unless there are any other questions.
There are two other members that okay. want to speak. Mr. Solaudio.
Thank you. No, honestly, I think as a whole, it's unsafe to be driving a motorcycle on a freeway. Because, you know, how can you compete as a motorcycle driver with trucks and cars and whatnot? But I do wonder if having motorcycle drivers put something on their head, whether that really helps more than hurts, and that, you know, your vision, your hearing do get impaired. I was, you know, struck by CHP response that they don't have a position, that the bill is currently written, there are practical issues with it. As well as I know that there's safety information on both sides, I think this is the kind of bill that maybe you ought to consider holding in committee to work out a way to see if there is at least a practical way to implement it. Whether there's policy support for it or not is a different question, but I'd like to support the bill. But as it's written, I think there are, you know, practical implementation issues with it. So I just wanted to share that.
I appreciate that. This is part of an ongoing dialogue, and this may not be the end of it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Before I call on Mr. Logue, Mr. Brown, did you want to add, Captain Brown, anything to that?
Madam Chair, just for the record, in the states of Arkansas, Florida, and Kentucky, and Louisiana, specifically Florida and Texas, when they repealed their helmet law, they saw an 81% increase in fatalities and involving motorcyclists. And in the state of Texas, there was 31% increase of fatalities. And that's information published as of March 2011.
Thank you, Mr. Logue.
Yeah, I ride a Harley, and if you put a helmet on, it does limit your visibility and your hearing. So there is definitely an impact with that. So I'm going to support your bill. I think it's a good bill. I think California has a tendency to over-regulate everything we do. It's a good example of being a nanny state. And I think if we're going to ride motorcycles, we're going to assume the responsibilities. Thank you.
Mr. Shadchan.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I do have concerns with the bill. Twofold. I also ride and I wear one even if there wasn't a law. And with today's new helmets, you can improve your view and the hearing. So spend a little more money, Mr. Logue. I can say that because he's a personal friend. My concern is twofold. One, in the county of San Luis Obispo, we have the Oceano Dunes. And I hate to see a person of any age riding without one because the collisions are as massive as they come. That's one. My other concern is if I was a highway patrolman, would I then pull somebody just to recognize that their age is above 18 and let them go? The excessive force it takes or effort it takes now to take me away from something better than just checking ages to see if they were legally wearing one or not wearing one. A couple of concerns I want to share. I know if it becomes the law, then it applies to all riders at all locations, and it raises a red flag for me.
Mr. Miller.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm glad to see this bill come back. I believe I co-authored it a couple of years ago, and I'm glad to be able to support it again. Thank you.
Mr. Jeffries.
On one hand, I strongly encourage everybody who's on public highways to wear a helmet. My personal background with the fire service, I served the Ortega Highway from Lake Elsinore to Orange County, and an incredible number of accidents. Even motorcycles hitting head-on going opposite directions. Really a brutal highway for a lot of riders. I'm not sure in many of those cases, and this even dates prior to the 1991 law, I'm not sure that a helmet would have saved lives, to be honest with you. I mean, there were traumatic injuries, hitting vehicles head-on, hitting the guardrails. I mean, I'm not sure that a helmet would change the outcome, but nonetheless, I would encourage someone, whenever they're on the public highway, to wear a helmet. Having said that, we are a nation of freedom. We are a nation that allows adults to make choices, good or bad. And I think that freedom has to be overriding. I think that freedom has to give error to err on the side of freedom and personal responsibility. And if somebody chooses to not wear a helmet, that's their choice. And we believe in choice, and I think that's the side we have to go on. And so I support this bill.
Thank you, Ms. Bonilla.
I just wanted to thank the CHP for giving us that information. For me, dealing with those facts and hearing them is very important. I think that opinion from right there on the highway at the site of the accidents is very compelling to me. And because of that, I will be opposing this bill. It is always a struggle between freedom and responsibility. In this case, those huge increases in fatalities, I found very compelling reason to not retreat from the current law as it is.
Thank you. I, too, will be opposing your bill, Mr. Norby. You know, I listened to the numbers of fatalities and, just as importantly, the ripple effect with each accident, with each death, with each loss, the spouses, the family members, the children, the community that is impacted by a loss. And for that reason, I'll be opposing your bill. Would you like to close?
Yes. I'm not in Kentucky. I'm not a member of the Texas State Legislature. I'm a member of the California State Legislature, and the only information we have is information supplied by the California Highway Patrol. And when we asked them for information, they didn't give us information about other states. They gave us information about California. And the information we have shows that this law does not save lives. It just doesn't. And to continue to say that it does and assert it is fine, but saying it doesn't necessarily make it true. To say that it does and to cast aspersions on the judgment of the people here today and the tens of thousands of motorcyclers are saying that I can somehow decide better for themselves what's the best interest in the safety and security of them and their families, and I don't believe that I can. We do have adult responsibilities. This bill would continue the requirement for those under the age of 18, but it says for adults, let those who ride decide.
There's one more question, Ms. Mitchell.
Thank you, I appreciate it. This, Mr. Norby, this debate reminds me of, you know, decades ago, the debate in this very house with regard to mandatory seatbelt laws, and where, you know, we could stack up the studies pro and con in terms of whether or not everyone wearing seatbelts truly saved lives, and it required a multi-year culture shift. My question to the Highway Patrol is, why do your CHP officers on motorcycle wear helmets?
Madam Chair, the reason for the helmet is that we do not have the luxury of having metal around us, protection around us in the event of a collision. Usually when a motorcycle is involved in a collision, the rider is ejected. And since the brain is what we're trying to protect, it runs the majority of the body, the helmet is used to protect that vital structure that runs what we call the automated systems of the body, heart, lungs, and maintain life, those things essential for life. So we wear helmets to protect our officers' heads. We also wear safety boots and gear to protect us in the event we go down. Because again, other injuries heal easily, but the brain injury does not recover or heal easily at all.
Madam Chair, I'd like to move the bill.
There was a motion and a second. Could you please call the roll?
The motions do pass to appropriations. Lowenthal.
No.
Lowenthal, no. Jeffries.
Aye.
Jeffries, aye. Ashajian. Blumenfield. Bonilla. No. Bonilla, no. Buchanan. Ng.
No.
Ng, no. Mitchell.
No.
Mitchell, no. Galgiani.
No.
Galgiani, no. Logue. Logue, aye. Miller.
Aye.
Miller, aye. Norby.
Aye.
Norby, aye. Portantino.
No.
Portantino, no. Solorio.
Four to seven.
I'll ask for reconsideration, Madam.
Four to six.
If it doesn't go through. Currently.
Thank you, Mr. Norby. Mr. Cedillo. Oh my God, look at them all. I didn't even see them.
Not heard that before.
Welcome.
Year four.
AB 353.
Are you ready, Madam Chair?
Yes, we're ready.
Madam Chair, members, this is a very simple bill, very clear on its face what it attempts to do. It is within a very complex and controversial context, but the bill itself that you will be voting on is very simple. It simply conforms for the city of South Pasadena the law as it applies to all other cities in the state of California.
Move the bill.
Which simply says that should you want to build a freeway through a city, that they should enter into an agreement with the state.
Build it and they will come. Please continue, Mr. Cedillo.
As I indicated, it simply states that for the city of South Pasadena, as for all other cities of the state of California, should you want to build a surface freeway, that you should have to come in and make an agreement with that city, as you do for other cities. I ask for an aye vote.
Thank you. Your witnesses?
Yes.
Witnesses.
I have the mayor of the
support.
City, the very courageous mayor for the city of South Pasadena is with us, the Honorable Mike Tin.
Madam Chair and esteemed assembly members, I come here today to represent not only the city of South Pasadena, but its 26,000 residents. We live in an age of polarization. We see it in the old Hatfields and McCoys. We see it, sometimes we read about it here in Sacramento. But again, down in the San Gabriel Valley, I guess the polarization is Alhambra versus South Pasadena. But the reason we're here today, it's not about stopping versus building. It's not about regional transportation needs versus environmental and community concerns. What is today we're really here is about fairness, good government, and transparency. It's about equal rights and protections under the law. We're here today to talk about removing an exclusion written into law, hidden in the highway state, the state highway code, so vague that it doesn't even mention the freeway. It doesn't even mention the city and its 26,000 residents that got its rights taken away almost 30 years ago. Today we're here to talk about leveling the playing field. This month, the most exhaustive and comprehensive study of our time will be studying the transportation needs and environmental and social concerns in this area to address a regional project. Many solutions and alternative options have become available to meet these needs and also the needs of the residents of Southern California. All we're asking is to remove an exclusion. A year ago, I was here, and I was, you know, every time I come here, I'm proud to to speak in front of you, but I was proud after I left. I got to hear an ACM over in the assembly room, Paul Fong, talk about recognizing the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882. Well, at least in that act, it signified the Chinese American people. In this particular exclusion, it doesn't even say whose rights are being taken away. All we're asking you is to recognize South Pasadena and the cities that are involved, that we all have rights and no city should be any different than any other city in the state of California. Thank you.
Thank you. Next witness. Okay. Any other witnesses in support? Witnesses in opposition?
Madam Chair, members of the committee, Jim Cassie, with the city of Alhambra, we have not sent a letter to Assemblyman Sedillo, although the 710 Coalition is opposed to the bill. It's not a real strong opposition, but we're concerned. We've had gridlock in Alhambra and other cities surrounding for 40 years, morning, noon, and night. The EIR for the tunnel is ongoing. If we can't build a tunnel, we'd like to still pursue a freeway. I know that's a stretch, but it's an option that would still remain on the table. I would offer from our mayor from Alhambra to Mayor Tin, now that the EIR is being done by MTA and Caltrans, to come join us. And let's find out all the answers that we need to know before we can move ahead with a P3 project to rid the San Gabriel Valley of a serious transportation problem. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else in opposition? If not, members? Mr. Ang?
Yeah, first of all, I want to thank Mr. Sedillo for his record of trying to work towards some type of resolution. And I commend, I've enjoyed working with the senator on this effort to really raise public consciousness of why we need to have some unanimity of agreement. I also want to commend Mr. Tin for working toward the same end of at least trying to understand and move things forward. And unfortunately, I know that you have not necessarily been rewarded for your efforts in terms of regional leadership. But I did have a little bit of concern and a question for the author. As you know, I come from a district where this freeway comes screeching to a halt right in my backyard, right in the middle of kids playing on the street, on the sidewalk, senior citizens trying to jog around the block, small businesses. And this lack of movement of over 40 years of non-resolution has caused problems. 18-wheelers cars that don't have GPS come to a dead end right in the middle of my district because they're looking for a path forward to another freeway. We have the highest rates of collisions, health disparities. And so I guess my question to the author is what are the efforts that you have made to work with the coalition, with the cities that I represent, in coming to some understanding and common ground with regard to this bill, which they oppose? Their concerns are that if they support a bill like this, that ultimately they would still not find any kind of resolution and acceptance for the tunnel route, because that certainly has not been the official position of the city that stands in opposition and is supporting this bill.
Madam Chair? I can appreciate your disappointment. It does make sense. It would seem that we would expect that the people of South Pasadena would be elated, that they would be in the streets celebrating the end of a 40-year battle, that they had fought to stop a freeway, one of the rare regions of Southern California that could say they do not have a freeway. They utilize freeways, you know, to come and go like everybody else in Southern California, community of 11 million people. We would expect that they would be elated, but they are not. And I appreciate your disappointment. We would expect that they would come clamoring and, you know, say, hey, this is great. We found an alternative that meets our needs and meets our goals and objectives. They have said for years, we want to protect the nature of our neighborhoods, that we, you know, we don't want the freeway coming through, you know, after, of course, everybody's built freeways through every other neighborhood. But we would expect that they would say that this is a great victory and a great accomplishment, and that they would join us in working together to solve and to close the gap. We would expect and hope that, but that's not the case. And it may be a result of too many years of battle. It may be a result of a lack of trust over the years. It may be the fact that they're unable to, given the fact that they've invested so much money in fighting the completion of the gap. They've depleted their city resources. Their infrastructure suffers as a result of them diverting resources to attorneys as opposed to their own infrastructure. And so I recognize that. I'm sensitive to that. But I think, Mr. Ng, and you and I worked together on this, we have to recognize progress as little as it may be, as small as and incremental as it may be. And we have to recognize, for example, that the elected leadership of that city is here, that the city is changing. That's merely a fact of demographics and aging, that some people are fatigued of this battle, not the hardcore ones who will never give up and who won't know what to do even when they win, not those, but the electorate, for example, who overwhelmingly voted for Measure R in the city of South Pasadena. And you and I worked on Measure R, and included in that is initial funding, and it's significant funding for the closure of this gap. We all understand that it would be a tunnel, it would go under, it would not disturb the residents there. So this is a victory. It's not celebrated, but it also is for us a step forward. Incremental as it may be, it is one way for us to take this off the table and to remove the argument, as baseless as it may be, remove the argument that there's some disadvantage that Alhambra and other cities have over the city of South Pasadena, that they're not being treated fairly, that they've had to suffer under the specter of this freeway, if you will. We on this moment, in this vote, will remove that argument, and no longer can they say that. And it'll be incumbent upon both the elected leadership and the local leadership to come forward and to engage the rest of the region in seeking a solution, because as you know, you and I have represented that area for many, many years together. Particularly, and I was one of the few persons who's represented both Alhambra and the city of South Pasadena. One of the few persons who understands from both sides the concerns that have been raised by my constituents at the time in both cities, that this problem must be solved, not just for South Pasadena and Alhambra, but for the region of San Gabriel Valley and for the entirety of Southern California. The Southern California Association of Governments has said this is the number one fetter on productivity. The 710 corridor is vital to the economic vitality of the region and of Southern California. It is from that port that the largest imports for the nation come through. So we must find a solution that not only resolves the questions for the city of Alhambra and South Pasadena, but for the surrounding cities and for the entirety of the region and the economy of the state.
Can I have a follow-up just to that? I'm sorry, Mr. Sedil. So I appreciate your stated willingness. What I want to ask is, I assume that you, I would like some assurance that you will work with the cities in my district, and if you're not able to find common ground should the bill get out, would you be willing to pull the bill off the table if you can't find that common ground?
I will continue to be open and working with dialogue with all the interested parties. It is my hope that we can find some type of vehicle, no pun, some type of vehicle to bring the groups together to move forward. This is progress. This demonstrates that we are continuing this. Let me say to you that I recognize that my time here is limited, as it is for all of us, but I do expect to continue to be engaged in this at the local level. And it is my intention, this is a as it is for you, and you've been a great champion on this, a major project for our districts and for our region, for which we will continue to work until we are unable to.
Okay, I'm going to lay off the bill, but as it moves forward, if that coalition does develop and you're able to meet the concerns of my residents, then I'm going to give it a second look. But I really wish you could pledge to take the bill off the table if that process doesn't happen. And I do understand what you just said.
Right.
Anyway, that's the extent of my comments. Thank you.
A couple other members, Mr. Shajian, and then Mr. Portantino.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
I'm supportive of the bill for the reasons that it empowers local government. I kind of wish that it also included the turnabouts, because I just heard from the city of Lompoc that they don't want it, but they're being imposed by the organization to have that in place. But I also want to take a moment and show my appreciation to Caltrans District 5, because they have worked very closely with the county of San Luis. Anytime there were issues with bridges, so I don't want to think that I'm bringing something or supporting something against them, because they have done an excellent job in my territory. So I want to thank them publicly, and I'll be supportive of this because it empowers local government. Having come from local county supervisors, I'll support this.
Mr. Portantino.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and members. I hope you'll indulge me as the assembly member who proudly represents the city of South Pasadena. I do have a few opinions on both this bill and also some of the discussion of the freeway and the tunnel. And I certainly applaud Mr. Cedillo for presenting this particular aspect of the issue, because South Pas is currently, to my knowledge, the only city in the state that does not have the right to negotiate directly with Caltrans. And that, as Mr. Cedillo has said, rightfully so, is a very straightforward injustice that should be corrected. And I strongly support returning South Pasadena's right that should never have been taken away in the first place. And taking away that right initially is sort of illustrative of sort of the extent to which the supporters of the freeway and the supporters of the tunnel will go, in that they would use Sacramento to pass a law to take away one of the most basic rights that cities have, which is the ability to negotiate. So we should all have that in the back of our mind, that this was done to use the legislative process to circumvent a local process at its core. So restoring that local process is very, very important, and I again commend Mr. Cedillo for writing that injustice. Madam Chair, if I could ask a question of the mayor of South Pass, and then I have some further comments, if that's okay. Is that all right, Madam Chair?
Please.
Mr. Mayor, it's my understanding that the City of South Pasadena's support for this legislation is only in its current form, that if it were to be amended, that the South Pasadena's support would not follow the bill if it's amended. Is that correct?
South Pasadena City Council supports this bill as written. As most of you would know, and all of your support gains on how it appears as it progresses through this process. What happens to it in the next step, the City Council of South Pasadena will have to determine. And it will be up to them to decide, and all five of us to decide on whether we support it or we don't.
But the resolution that was passed by the council, doesn't it automatically bring it back?
Oh, to this, yes.
Right. So in the resolution that it's important because in the resolution that the City of South Pasadena passed, it is only supportive of the bill in its current form, and that if the bill changes, the City of South Pasadena had directed your city manager to bring it back to you for further action, that the support does not carry if the bill is changed.
Correct.
Okay. I just want to make that clear as the representative of the City of South Pasadena. It's important for me to represent the wishes of the city properly. And so I just want to make sure I'm clear on that because that's what council members have told me. So thank you for clearing that up. And I think that's important in light of Mr. Ng's concerns, and Mr. Cedillo and I had a very good conversation earlier today. And it's my understanding that there is no intention to have this bill changed because I take Mr. Cedillo at his word and his opening comment about this being a very straightforward fix of an injustice. And so I would ask if for some reason Mr. Ng is successful of bringing the coalition to the table and this bill changes, that Madam Chair, we bring it back to the committee if it changes to be something that it's not. And so I hope that is the case. As far as the freeway and the tunnel goes, there is some disagreement about in the region, and the City of Glendale has just come on as a very strong opponent of spending upwards of $20 billion, and let me say that again, members, upwards of $20 billion on a 4.5-mile transportation project that does not solve a transportation project. And I would ask anyone in this room in a time when there is a severe budget crisis, should we be moving forward on a project where we don't know how much it's going to cost and we don't know how many cars are going to use it? No one would certainly build an addition on their house if they didn't know how many square feet they were going to be adding and how many people were going to be inhabiting your house. So we have to take great care. And I would like to correct one thing that was said by one of the advocates in the EIR. It is not necessarily looking at the tunnel, but looking at broad options on the table. And there are surface improvements, other things, light rail, many, many things in that EIR process. So it's important that we don't predetermine the outcome when our tax dollars are being spent, especially at a time when there are limited tax dollars. Again, I'd like to close by complimenting Mr. Cedillo, who has recognized an injustice, who proudly represented the City of South Pasadena for 8 years, and I think is doing the city a very good service by closing this hall. Thank you.
Mr. Cedillo, I want to congratulate you for continuing to be a champion here. And every baby step counts. It moves us toward construction. So I'm going to support your bill. And there is a motion and a second, is there not? Madam Secretary, could you,
Madam Chair,
would
thank
you like to close? Sorry about that.
Well, no, just thank you. There is a, the conversation moved away from the sum and substance of the bill to the broader, more complicated context for which it exists. But as I said, this takes those excuses, if you will, off the table and clears the discussion for what are the what will be the only vehicle, the only mechanism to close that gap. It must be closed. The conditions, Assemblymember Ng, are intolerable. They are unacceptable. They have public health implications. People along the corridor are impacted disproportionately. That is where the injustice is. And so this gap must be closed, and this matter must be resolved. If this moves us forward in that direction, then this is the act that I am willing to take to resolve a 40 to 50 year conflict. We must move off the dime, if you will. The demographics have changed dramatically, and the impact on our economy can no longer be tolerated.
This is one of the most important corridors in the entire nation in terms of its economic impact, because it ties us to the port of Long Beach. That is vital to our economic and national security. This is key. This is one of the most, I'll say it again, one of the most important corridors in the nation, and we cannot tolerate that this gets stopped on Valley Boulevard. And so this is one, I believe, one step closer to constructing a very real and serious and mature and responsible dialogue that must take place, including the city of South Pasadena, including all the other cities along the corridor. The time for being able to have a private freeway or to live in these idyllic situations without anybody else being impacted no longer exists in Southern California. That's a megapolis of over 11 million people, and we must figure out, both for the health of the region, the state, and the nation, how we resolve this problem. I hope and believe this will move us forward in that direction, and I thank you for your support, and I ask for an aye vote.
Thank you. Madam Secretary, could you call the roll?
The motion's due pass to appropriations. Lowenthal.
Aye.
Lowenthal, aye. Jeffries.
Aye.
Jeffries, aye. Ashajian.
Aye.
Ashajian, aye. Blumenfeld. Bonilla.
Aye.
Bonilla, aye. Buchanan. Ng. Mitchell.
Aye.
Mitchell, aye. Galgiani. Logue.
Aye.
Logue, aye. Miller.
Aye.
Miller, aye. Norby.
Aye.
Portantino.
Aye.
Portantino, aye. Solorio.
Solorio, aye.
9-0.
9-0. Your bill is out, Mr. Sedillo.
Thank you.
Mr. Jones. AB 474.
Thank you, members. Madam Chair and members, as you're aware, smog inspections are required for all vehicles with the exception of certain diesel, electric, natural gas powered vehicles and hybrids. Well, thank you. The purpose of this bill is born out of my experience in the auto industry and motorcycle industry in allowing California families a longer time period to be able to sell their vehicles and have their smog certificates valid for a longer period of time, from 90 days to 180 days. And with the motion and second, I'd be happy to continue my presentation or take questions from the panel.
Do you have any witnesses in support?
No, I do
not.
Or
you?
No.
Or are there any witnesses in opposition? If so, please come up.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair, members. I'm Bonnie Holmes-Jen. I'm with the American Lung Association in California. And we are opposed to this bill. The American Lung Association is, of course, very focused on cleaning up smog in California. And as you know, motor vehicles are a major source of pollution in California that causes serious illness and even premature death. And the Smog Check program is the key program to address emissions from in-use vehicles. And we're very concerned that this program is necessary to make sure that smog equipment is working correctly and that we are getting as much reductions as possible to help clean up the air. Now, this bill, from our perspective, is fairly arbitrary, and we think it's bad for air quality because it would extend the time period for the certification, for the smog check certification, for another 3 months, which is potentially another 3 months of noncompliance with our air quality standards. And we're also very concerned that it's bad for consumers because used car buyers are then at greater risk for buying a vehicle that is not compliant with our smog standards. So we don't see any compelling reason for this time extension. The bill seems fairly arbitrary to us. It would erode an important clean air program, and we would urge a no vote.
Thank you. Other witnesses?
Tom Addison with the Bay Area Air Quality Management District, here today on behalf of the chair of our legislative committee. Our concern with the bill is that it would increase emissions. Smog Check is the program in the state that we have to keep the cars and trucks that are on the road today operating cleanly. Most of our air quality problem in California today comes from our cars and trucks. Thus, bills like this that would reduce the effectiveness of the Smog Check program and increase emissions do not help us to achieve our air quality goals. They go in the opposite direction. By doubling the length of time from 3 to 6 months that a smog check is valid for prior to the sale of a vehicle, that increases emissions. It also, as the previous speakers noted, is bad for purchasers of used cars in this state, making them liable for emissions-related repairs instead of the seller of the vehicle.
Thank you. There was a comment, Mr. Jeffries.
Well, I think there's some lacking any evidence here today. There's two scenarios here that I see play out, one directly related to your bill and one not so much. I mean, let me have the indulgence here of the committee. Personal experience, almost close to this, but not quite the same. We have a vehicle, had to be, annual registration, had to be smogged. At one time, we had to replace the gas cap because the engine light came on. We replace the gas cap, the engine light goes off, we go get the test. It passes everything except the computer record says at one time you had an engine light on. The instructions to fix that are to drive your vehicle around for a week or two until the computer clears. I'm not sure that really helps clean the air as a method of compliance. But that was the official instructions. Drive your vehicle around for a week or two, and it'll eventually clear the computer. In this case, we have vehicles that were previously smogged, approved. Now we're going to tell millions of vehicle owners, when you sell your car that was licensed, registered, and smogged, we want millions of people to now go drive to a smog location, put the extra miles on, use more gas to go get the same test that you had previously that authorized it in the first place. And that's going to help clean the air. We might catch 1 out of 1,000 people who change the emissions. The net gain of this, I suspect, is a huge loss for improving the air in California by having millions of vehicles smogged unnecessarily. And assume it's not a million. Let's assume it's 10,000. We still have a net loss for improving air quality by requiring vehicles to get a test unnecessarily so we can catch 1 out of 1,000, 1 out of 10,000. Your bill is absolutely right if your objective is to help clean the air and make sure that we're not wasting people's time and their money, taking time off from work, putting vehicles on the road to go get tests that they had 90 days or a year prior to that. So I support your bill.
Thank you.
Any other comments? Mr. Jones, extending smog certificates for the additional 90 days could, though, result in vehicles being out of compliance. And what that means is they might not meet our emission standards. Coming from an area of Southern California where we've struggled with clean air because we have so many deaths a year, I am sorry, but I can't support your bill because I do want to stay as close to those times when you need to get the smog certificate as possible. If I have a choice of smog certificates and saving lives, I'll always save lives. So my recommendation would be to oppose your bill. Would you like to close?
Yes, absolutely. And if I can just, that comment came up several times from the witnesses, and I just want to address the non-compliance concern first, and then I'll go into my closing statements. My bill does nothing to change the deadline or the requirement for when a smog certificate is due to the state. So that deadline remains the same. My bill doesn't change it. The only thing that my bill does is extend the time period that that smog certificate is valid from 90 days to 100 day, 180 days for the purpose of basically making it easier for consumers in California when they're anticipating selling their vehicle or trading it in. And if they choose to sell it themselves rather than trade it in, sometimes they can, you know, get another 25% more value out of the vehicle by selling it themselves. And sometimes it takes longer than 90 days to finish that transaction. So that's the main driving force behind the bill. Let me go into some comments that may address some of the concerns from the witnesses opposed. Extending smog certificates by an additional 3 months will neither incur any cost for the state, create a loss of revenue, nor will it undermine the current emission and air quality standards. As a case in point, according to information from the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, the EPA, which regulates emissions of air pollutants such as sulfur dioxide and nitrogen oxide, nationwide air quality for the 6 pollutants for which there are national standards has improved significantly in recent decades. Since 1980, this is a quote from the EPA, since 1980, emissions of the 6 principal pollutants have declined significantly, end quote. The EPA publication, 6 Principal Pollutants, reports, further, for the first half of 2009, sulfur dioxide emissions dropped 24% versus the first half of 2008. Emissions of nitrogen oxide fell 5% in May and 11% in June of 2009 compared against the same months of the previous year, end quote. The fact that I could smog my car on January 1st, decide to sell it, but by April 1st it is already considered out of compliance, I would need to then again smog it, just doesn't make sense. A certificate issued to a licensed motor vehicle dealer is valid for a 2-year period, or until the vehicle is sold and registered to a retail buyer, whichever occurs first. And I'm just asking for 180 days. The legislature is rightly accused of being out of touch with the citizens of the state, and passage of AB 474 will provide direct relief from an overly rigid California statute. Thus, it makes sense from an economic perspective, but from a consumer perspective as well, to extend the current smog certification from 90 days to 6 months. Members, not only does California have the strictest emission standards in the nation, but it also has the unfortunate distinction of having one of the highest costs of living. In fact, the Council for Community and Economic Research reports that living in California roughly is 40% above the national average. Let's stop being so inflexible and provide a bit more room when it comes to smogging our vehicles. I ask for your aye vote. And then also to address some other concerns from the witnesses. One of the concerns brought up was greater risk to a buyer in purchasing a vehicle in noncompliance. Again, my bill does not address noncompliance. It does not change the regulations. It does not change the requirements for the smog certificate. It only extends the time period that smog certificate is valid. Under current law, the seller of a vehicle is responsible for making sure that that vehicle is smog legal at the time the vehicle is sold. That does not change. And another issue brought up by the witnesses was increased emissions. There's nothing in this bill that changes the emission standards by which any car should be smogged by. It only extends the time period by 90 days that the smog certificate is valid. I ask for your aye vote.
Thank you. Seeing no other comments, Madam Secretary, could you call the roll?
The motion is to pass to appropriation. Lowenthal.
No.
Lowenthal, no. Jeffries.
Aye.
Jeffries, aye. Ashajian. Ashajian, aye. Blumenfeld. Bonilla. Buchanan. Ng. Ng, no. Mitchell.
No.
Mitchell, no. Galgiani. Logue. Logue, aye. Miller.
Aye.
Miller, aye. Norby.
Aye.
Norby, aye. Portantino. Mm-hmm. Solorio.
No.
Solorio, no. Portantino, no.
Five. Your bill is on call.
All right. Thank you. And if by the end of the day, if it doesn't pass, I'd like to request reconsideration.
Yes.
Thank you.
Mr. Jones, could you present AB 953?
Absolutely. And I have some witnesses coming forward for this bill. Madam Chair, members, AB 953 pertains to the need for a new reliable investment-grade ridership study. This is dealing regarding high-speed rail authority. Please let me reassure you that this is not the, it is not the intent of this bill to kill the high-speed rail in California. The intent is to ensure that the if high-speed rail is going to be built, that it is done right, built on an accurate and reliable ridership study. Proposition 1A, which authorized $9.95 billion in bond funds for the construction of high-speed rail in California, conditioned the allocation, commitment, and expenditure of these funds only after submittal and approval of a funding plan. The funding plan is to include projected ridership and revenue estimates based on a ridership study. The current ridership study has been the subject of significant criticism, not only by the peer review committee established by Proposition 1A, but also by the most respected authority on the subject of ridership studies, the Berkeley Institute of Transportation Studies, ITS. ITS was created as an organized research unit in 1948 by the California legislature and has been long considered a legislative expert on transportation issues. And last year, the Senate Transportation and Housing Committee commissioned a study by ITS. The study, which was issued on June 30, 2010, concluded that there are, quote, significant problems that render the key demand forecasting models unreliable for policy analysis, end quote. The study further concluded, quote, the combination of problems in the development phase and subsequent changes made to model parameters in validation phases implies that the forecast of high-speed rail demand and hence the profitability of the proposed high-speed rail system have very large error bounds. These bounds, which are not quantified by Cambridge Systematics, may be large enough to include the possibility that California high-speed rail may achieve healthy profits and the possibility that it may incur significant revenue shortfalls. We believe that further work to both assess and reduce these bounds should be a high priority, end quote. The report stated as well that, quote, the authority must have demand and revenue forecasts that are reliable for policy and financial analysis. Without them, there is little basis for proceeding. We recommend that the authority work with the UC Berkeley and Cambridge Systematics on an expedited basis to complete the analysis of the issues in the demand modeling, especially biases in model coefficients and the reliability of the estimates in order to develop estimates that are generally agreed to be the best that can be obtained, end quote. The bottom line is ITS from UC Berkeley believes that any reliable ridership study must be based on new data collection. To do anything else will result in garbage in, garbage out, no matter how many times you analyze the current inaccurate data. Members, a ridership study is crucial for numerous reasons. It will determine everything from the best routes to the frequency of trains and service and parking spaces. Ridership studies determine whether HSR high-speed rail will pay for itself, what the fare box revenues should be to recover costs, including loans. Ridership studies are also critical to giving confidence to the private sector and Wall Street, who will indeed demand a reliable investment-grade ridership study before considering or committing any private sector funding. Wall Street is acutely aware that the current ridership study by Cambridge Systematics is critically flawed. Members, while I believe it is imprudent to spend any money on a project that is based on a flawed ridership study, it is not the intent of this bill to curtail what is already in progress. Hence, based on discussions with and concerns expressed by the committee staff and others, I would like to amend this bill to delete any further reference to the prohibition of the use of Prop 1A funds. I would like to strike lines 3, starting with notwithstanding through lines 9, ending with the word methodology. This will ensure that the work in progress is not affected by this bill and federal funds are not at risk, while also ensuring that a reliable investment-grade ridership is secured for the future decisions made by the authority. With these changes, I ask for your support on this important measure. With me here today are Elizabeth Alexis, who is an expert in economics and very knowledgeable on ridership studies, as well as David Armenta, mayor of the city of Pico Rivera, sponsors of the bill, and Ravi Mehta, also helping with the bill. Thank you. That's my opening presentation.
3 and 9. Witnesses in support, Mr. Jones.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair and members of the committee. My name is Elizabeth Alexis. I am a co-founder of CARD, which is a nonprofit, all-volunteer group set up to focus on process, not solutions, for this project. We support the bill, especially the part about taking advantage of the skills and knowledge that the ITS represents. This is a unique opportunity that the legislature has. We agree with the section to strike any part of this bill that ties it to the funding, because this is not about whether you support high-speed rail or not. It's about whether policy should be guided by science or whether it should be guided by guns for hire. First, the ridership model matters. Gilroy's parking requirement of 6,000 spaces that was directly linked to this model led to a no-confidence vote. It's not helping the project. The overemphasis on frequency and underemphasis on ease of getting to station means two stations will be built in San Francisco and one will be dropped in Los Angeles. This will hurt high-speed rail's profits. The ridership model is guiding multi-billion dollar decisions. You want a good one. You want one that's open to the public. Guns for hire concept has issues. Most people, including legislators on both sides of the aisle, discount the findings. Everyone has assumed a private firm would come forward with its own model, but they have not. Cambridge had to indemnify the state for the mistakes in its model. This has put them in a position that they risk their firm's existence if they acknowledge any issue, as they have probably cost the state now tens of millions of dollars. This is leading to a situation where the state may now waste billions of dollars. The legislature needs someone working for the legislature. In Japan, where high-speed rail has been done successfully, it is a given that the government has a model, the train company has a model. It allows a healthy negotiation to go on about funding. It is better late than never. Many of the key decisions about capacity needs in Los Angeles and the Bay Area will not happen for a while. If you don't get started now, you'll never get to the point at which you have this model. The current model is fatally flawed. You have a handout at the back of which it shows the difference between how Californians actually travel and who Cambridge sampled for this study. They themselves then did a test to see whether this would be a problem. They failed the test, and then they just decided to ignore the results. This led to a series of cascading problems, not the least of which was the flaws in the current environmental review.
Thank you. That was a little over 2 minutes.
Okay, and I'll take any questions that people have about the model.
Okay, I appreciate that. Next witness in support.
Madam Chair and members, my name is David Armenta, Mayor of the City of Pico Rivera in Los Angeles County. Our city of approximately 65,000 residents is predominantly Hispanic, with a per capita income of approximately $15,000, with more than 15% of the population living below the poverty line and about 18% unemployment. I am here today to urge you to support AB 953 as amended, because the decision being made by the High Speed Rail Authority are going to have a significant impact on Pico Rivera and its residents. The authority has decided based on the flawed and unreliable ridership study prepared by Cambridge Systematics that the route for the Los Angeles to Anaheim corridor, as well as the Los Angeles to San Diego corridor, will run through the city, bisecting Pico Rivera into three parts. The proposed tracks will be built on a viaduct 30 feet high to approximately 60 feet high. The authority has been deaf to our concerns, citing the reliability of their flawed ridership study. We all know that a reliable ridership study is the foundation of a good transportation system. It is the very essence of which routes will be selected, how many trains are needed, the frequency of the trains, how many tracks are needed, as well as where and how many stations need to be built. A new ridership study will not hinder in any way affect what the authority is currently doing in the Central Valley, nor will it affect the federal funding that has been granted. However, a new ridership study will serve to enhance future planning and development of high-speed rail in California. Why would you be afraid to get a second opinion from world-renowned experts in transportation studies? Would you not get a second opinion if you're doing a major remodel to your home? Would you not get a second opinion if you were told your car needed major repair? Would you not get a second opinion if you were had a serious medical problem? Do you want a new ridership study when you are being told by ITS, the authority's own peer review committee and other experts that the current study is fatally flawed. The Berkeley Institute of Transportation is an arm of the legislature. If you have an independent, unbiased ridership study from them, it will either validate what we already have or it will identify problems that exist, thus saving us from building in the wrong areas, building too little, too much, and costing the state billions of dollars.
Thank you, Mr. Armenta.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Other witnesses in support? Please state your name and affiliation.
Yes, thank you. Larry Klein, Palo Alto City Council Member and Chair of Palo Alto's Rail Committee.
Thank you. Are there other witnesses in support?
May I
please
just say a few words?
No, we only have two witnesses in support, two in opposition. The remainder share their name and affiliation.
We're in support of AB 953 as amended. Thank you.
Thank you. Other witnesses in support?
Ravi Mehta, appearing on behalf of the cities of Atherton, Menlo Park, Pico Rivera, and Palo Alto, in support.
Thank you.
Jeffrey Prang, Assistant City Manager for the City of Pico Rivera, in support.
Richard Tolmack, California Rail Foundation, in support.
Thank you. Other witnesses in support?
Kathy Hamilton, board member of Community Coalition on High Speed Rail. I'm in support.
Jenna Price for the Planning and Conservation League, in support.
Don Barnby, Menlo Park. Ridership is the key to everything. Let's learn the facts. Thank you.
Jerry Carlson, representing the Town of Atherton City Council, in support.
James Jans, President of the Community Coalition on High Speed Rail. We support this measure.
Holly Millar, San Francisco. I support this measure.
Are there witnesses in opposition? Please come forward. We make room at the table for...
Should I speak here or at the table?
Please, two witnesses in opposition at the table.
Madam Chair, Assembly Members, my name is Mark Kyle, and with Operating Engineers Local Union Number 3, we represent approximately 28,000 workers here in Northern California, approximately 10,000 in construction. I'm here this afternoon to say that we're in opposition to this bill. We believe that it's redundant, that despite the proposed amendment striking the most onerous parts of the bill, it's unnecessary. While we believe that another ridership study would be useful, we believe tying it to the funding, tying it to the timing, would detrimentally and adversely affect the workings of the authority and the board moving forward, and could potentially jeopardize federal funds, as well as a number of the timings on the environmental impact report. My understanding of why ITS, which had done a previous study, didn't do one on ridership numbers at the time is that they lacked the adequate expertise to do so. So I guess they'd have to find somebody to do that. So we believe that's unnecessary. Why we would support another study, we think it should be done in support of and not as a possible obstacle to moving forward. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, committee members. My name is Daniel Krause. I'm executive director with Californians for High Speed Rail. We're a nonprofit grassroots group that our sole mission is to make sure this project is implemented in for the riders of the state of California who voted for this project. In terms of this bill, we oppose this bill strongly. Even with the proposed amendment, it's our feeling that the bill will still essentially kill the project in that they will not be able to get federal funding if the EIR is delayed. So that's a critical point that we need to consider. The bill states that they need to wait to complete environmental work until the new ridership study is done, which would be about a year and a half. So that would mean stimulus money, deadlines would pass, we would not be able to proceed with the project, so hence this bill could potentially lead to the ending of the project. We also
view the ridership study debate as one of a debate amongst academics regarding methodology. The author of the ITS report actually said he was not concluding one way or the other whether that ridership would be lower or higher based on the Cambridge systematic study. It's more about a quibble about methodology. So I think this is more of making a mountain out of a molehill, essentially, in terms of debating whether the ridership study is accurate or not. We also are open to the idea of doing another ridership study in conjunction with an updated business plan. That does have merit, and we support that, but that should be done in a time frame that allows the project to move forward as business plans will continue to be revised. You might want to continue to look at the ridership numbers based on how you're designing the system. California will definitely have high ridership in this. I mean, we have an ideal setup with large cities and growing cities in between. From Fresno, Bakersfield, they're going to continue to grow. We've got the Bay Area and also the LA. We're going to have high ridership all over the world. High-speed rail systems are performed extremely well in terms of ridership, and they're producing profits in terms of operations. And I thank you for your time.
Thank you very much. Other witnesses in opposition?
Patrick Henning on behalf of the California State Council of Labor is in opposition. I just wanted to correct the record, obviously, that UC, University of California at Berkeley is not an arm of the legislature, as much as some may want that. But there are some other fine institutions that could possibly do the study. We'd like to see the process opened up to not just one singular.
Thank you. Opposition, state your name and affiliation, please.
Jaffer Rizvi with CalPERG.
Thank you. In opposition, please.
Mark Smith on behalf of the American Council of Engineering Companies in opposition for the reasons previously stated.
Nick Cronowitz, Sacramento, California, for Californians for High Speed Rail. We strongly oppose this bill.
Tim Smith, State Chairman, Brother to Locomotive Engineers and Trainmen Teamsters. We oppose this bill for the reasons so stated. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Galgiani.
First of all, I do want to make clear as the author of Prop 1A that this bill would stop $5.5 billion in funding to California. It would stop 110,000 jobs. Secondly, one of the witnesses raised the point that we would need a second opinion and that the authority is not getting any second opinions. That's not quite accurate. We actually have memorandums of understanding with 8 different countries that have built high-speed systems around the world, and we have more than 235 senior planners and managers that are advising the authority as they move forward. I want to convey my utmost, respect to those who are here from Palo Alto and Atherton and Menlo Park, and as I understand Pico Rivera today, and I would pledge to work with you going forward with some of the issues that you have. But I would suggest that too much focus has been placed on